Okay, thanks a lot, Abhishek, and very nice to see you all here early Monday morning. I'd like to see what you all look like Friday, right? Anyway, let's see. Okay, so I'm going to talk about phenomena which are very commonplace and yet very striking and very important, partly because they are commonplace and also because they're striking. You know, and the phenomena have to do with phase transitions. So I think you all are all familiar with phase transitions, and those of you who are not before you all came here, Abhishek has been giving you all these lectures the last few days, so you're up on board. So just to, you know, remind you anyway, if you look at the phase diagram of a simple ferromagnet, simple model ferromagnet, in the plane of the magnetic field H and temperature T, you find that most of the phase diagram is pretty innocuous as you change field or temperature and you take a path like this in an experiment. You see things changing, but not dramatically. They do change dramatically as you cross this line. This green line is a line of first order phase transitions. A first order phase transition is one in which the first derivative of the free energy has a jump, a first derivative, not all, not necessarily all. For instance, as you cross this line, the magnetization has a jump, not the entropy. The entropy is also first derivative. Turns out the entropy doesn't jump because there's a symmetry in the magnet. So one jumping is enough. But as you know, the magnitude of the jump depends on the value of the temperature. So as you go higher and higher, the magnitude of the jump decreases and actually vanishes at the red point. So I'm going to use this color convention. Color convention was established many years ago by Robert Griffiths. First order transitions, green. Critical points, red. Or critical lines, also red. Okay, so this point is a critical point. So I'll call this temperature TC, theory temperature. What are the coordinates of the critical point? T equal to TC, H equal to 0. Of course, critical points and first order transitions are seen all over, not only in magnets. For instance, if you go to a fluid system, not totally fluid actually in this plane, becomes solid somewhere, you will recall from somewhere, maybe from school or college, a phase diagram that looks like this. Pressure temperature plane, lines which are green, which means that if you cross them in an experiment by changing, let's say, the pressure at a fixed temperature, or by changing the temperature at a fixed pressure, either way, you get a jump. This time it's a jump, clearly not in the magnetization, because there's no magnetic property, it's a jump in the density. And what does that correspond to? Simply liquid going to vapor. For instance, along this line, some other line, if you cross, you'll enter a solid phase. This line may go this way, it may go that way, depending on the substance. Does anybody know for water, which way does it go, this way or that way? I mean, this way. This way? Yes, that's right, goes left. That's anomalous, actually. And water is anomalous in many senses, but there it is. At what temperature does water boil at normal pressure? 100 Fahrenheit Celsius. Okay, can you convert that to a Kelvin? 373. So the reason I did that is to tell you that water boils at 373 Kelvin. The critical point of water is 373 centigrade. So remember this. It's just something that's easy to remember. 373 centigrade is where the critical point is. And of course, there's a critical pressure. It turns out to be about 220 atmospheres. Okay, so this is just background information. I think I have to stop giving background information, otherwise I just keep talking. All right, now, okay, good. Here I've put down some things that we will need as the lecture goes on, and we'll come back to that. Now, the sort of story, actually there's a whole story here that I'm going to tell started at a more or less precise date. This was 1965. There was a conference in Washington, D.C., and many people got together, people from magnetism, people from fluids, people from doing low temperature physics, and they all got together, mainly experimentalists, some theorists, and they displayed a lot of data to each other. And they found remarkable similarities in the data that existed for liquids and for magnets and for superfluids and this and that. I mean, and it seemed there was more to it than met the eye. And in fact, what people were beginning to understand in that meeting is that there are some very striking things that happen in the vicinity of these red points. Whether it's a fluid red point or a superconducting red point or a superfluid red point or a magnetic red point or a ferroelectric red point doesn't matter so much. The fact that it's red matters, I mean, it's critical. Because you find that near the critical point, there are certain simplifications. The equation of state. Are you all familiar with the equation of state? Give me one equation of state. Very good. So that's the equation of state of an ideal gas. There's also an equation of state for an ideal magnet, but we'll leave it. We'll leave that alone for the moment. But the equation of state, which of course deviates from the ideal gas equation of state when you have dense liquids and, you know, phenomena near phase transitions, that equation of state becomes very, very simple near the critical point. And it begins to have new properties, which are known as scaling, which go under the name of scaling. So the first thing is that these people in 1965 found is that all the systems obeyed scaling. Why should that be? Not very clear. I mean, I hope I'm getting the chronology exactly right, but I mean, scaling was in the air then. Now, not only did they find that all these different systems and substances obey scaling near a critical point, but also the quantitative characterization of these in terms of exponents. I think you'll have had some exposure to exponents from Abhishek, or not quite. Some of them. No scaling, but exponents. So they measured these exponents and found that they're the same. I mean, this was actually known for some time, since 1945, from these experiments of Fowler and Guggenheim, that for many liquids, if you plot the coexistence curves, you know, in a properly scaled way, they all fall on top of each other. So whether the liquid is an inert liquid like neon, or whether it's a complicated thing like methane, you know, near the critical point, these exponents are exactly the same. That's a bit of a mystery, because the critical temperature itself varies a lot as you change the liquid. The critical pressure varies a lot. Everything is all over the place. Yet, when you go to the, you know, vicinity of this red point, everything becomes similar. Why should that be? So this phenomenon was called universality. And there is this notion of universality. It just happens, and it's a puzzling thing. Not only that, there were people from magnetism there, there were people from liquids there. I mean, I'm not sure this is exactly what happened in 1865, but you know, let us say this is what happened. You know, and then they were comparing their data, and they found these exponents are the same for liquids and magnets as well. So this universality is pretty universal. I mean, it extends not only, you know, amongst the class of like systems like liquids, but also between liquids and magnets, and so on. So there's something mysterious, something strange, and yet something simple that is happening here. And this is what these lectures we want to convey, you know, what it is that happens, and if possible, why is it that happens? You know, this is what we want to 1965. Okay, that's already quite a few years back. Quickly, somebody tell me how many. I'm sort of bad at math. 50? more than 50 years. But 100 years before 1965, that is about 1865, was the first time a critical point was ever seen. These are the experiments of Andrews. Now, Andrews was a chemist, and he was quite a decorated chemist. I mean, I was just reading about him. He was given various medals by the Royal Society long before the 1860s. But in the 1860s, he did these experiments. 1863, he first of all liquefied carbon dioxide, okay, by applying pressure, and then kept changing the pressure and seeing what happens. And what he found is what we now know quite well is that the density jump kept getting smaller and smaller. So then he wondered to himself, can it be that the density jump will get to zero? And if it gets to zero, what will it mean? And sure enough, he found that it does. So the coordinates of this point for carbon dioxide are, I mean, it's quite an accessible temperature, especially in Bombay, or Hyderabad, maybe not Bangalore, 31 degrees. Here it's some nice cool 20s, but okay. Room temperature in Bombay, 31 degrees. But if you have carbon dioxide at room temperature in Bombay, it will still be a gas. So how come you found this 31 degrees? Pressure. So this is atmospheric pressure. So you have to apply pressure. And for carbon dioxide, the critical pressure is about 77 atmospheres. By the way, you all should have some idea of pressure. What is the pressure right now in atmospheres? One atmosphere, because there's one atmosphere above us. Now, in normal life, do you think you can withstand any 100 atmospheres? Yes? Yeah, something will ever happen to your ears. Okay, leave out the ears. Take your skin. Okay? Can your skin withstand 100 atmospheres? Yeah, it can. Because I'll do a simple experiment. Take your nail, press hard against your skin, as hard as you can. Skin doesn't break, it may indent. This pressure is about 6,000 atmospheres. So your skin is pretty tough. All right. This is just, again, my usual meandering. We'll come back to this. So, the point is that, so to summarize everything I've said, you can forget about most things. You know, all these systems that we're interested in, at least today, have a red point somewhere in the phase diagram. And we are going to be interested in what happens near the red point because, as I said, there are strange scaling properties and strange striking universal properties that extend over many systems. So this is the motivation. Now, all right. Okay, let me now tell you what I'm going to try to do in this lecture, because you should have an idea what we're going to do. And I'm going to try to do three main things. One is scaling. I'll describe this and tell you what it is. I mean, scaling can be approached in many ways. I'll approach it in a very functional way, a way that is of immediate use to analyze data in experiment. Two, we'll talk about some theoretical models. And in particular, the model I'll most be dealing with in these lectures will be the Ising model. And again, I believe Abhishek must have introduced the Ising model. So you all are familiar with the Ising model, except the Ising model, the way you might know it, is as a lattice model of spins which can be up or down, which is perfectly correct and fine way. This is the way it was done when Ising did his PhD and solved the 1D Ising model. But there are other ways of thinking about the Ising model, and we'll try to discuss some of them as well. So something called the Landau-Ginsberg-Wilson-Hamiltonian, which is tantamount to the Ising model, which is equivalent to the Ising model, we'll derive that. And the third thing I'd like to do is actually, just introduce the renormalization group, the procedure, the main idea, And if possible, and I'll try to reach that. By the way, today I have to leave exactly at 11 o'clock. You know, there's some meeting I have to go to. So I'm going to try to pace myself and reach that point. And I want to conclude by trying to show that the RG idea and the formalism actually leads to scaling. So this is my plan for today. The reason I put it up is so that, you know, there'll be a bit of a break between this and this and this and that. So don't get thrown off. We are going to do these three. All right, so here we go. Okay. All right, so let's imagine that we're doing these experiments here. We're all experimentalists and we're measuring isotherms, meaning at a given temperature, we're varying the magnetic field and seeing what magnetization we have. Okay, and we're doing it at various temperatures below TC, through TC, and above TC. What do we see? Well, we see curves like this, M versus H. So let's say I'm above TC. Then clearly the magnetization has no jump. It just goes through the origin in some smooth way. If I raise the temperature a little bit, the curve will be similar, except it'll be a sort of more like a lazy curve. It'll go slowly from one side to the other, and so on. And if I'm even closer to TC, then of course this will be quite sharp, but still we go through. Now, if I'm a very diligent experimentalist and I want data, 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 then what I do is keep measuring at every possible temperature, and I'll keep getting more and more curves, and that's very good because you're getting a lot of data. But turns out you don't have to work that hard. It turns out that if you do something that I'll call scaling, which is the following. These are all at different temperatures, right? But they're all plotting the same thing, M versus H, M versus H, M versus H. Okay? But since they're different temperatures, let me scale M by a simple function of temperature. Let me scale H by an equally simple function of temperature. Now, one bit of notation I forgot to define. Little t, you know, since we're going to be dealing with the vicinity of the red point, let me define the deviation from that red point in terms of temperature as little t. So, where shall I write it? Little t is t minus tc. But then since tc can vary a lot, like for helium, what is the liquid vapor critical point temperature of helium? Helium 4. Nobody does low temperature experiments here? Sorry? 2 Kelvin, not quite right. It's in the general 2 Kelvin, something else happens. It becomes superfluid. When does it first form a liquid? The answer is the critical temperature is about 4.2. Am I right? About 4 degrees Kelvin. No, so the point I was trying to make is that since TC varies a lot from, let's say, 4 degrees for helium to 373 centigrade for water, and we want a variable, I mean, it's sensible to divide this by TC. So we think of little t as t minus tc over tc. Tc varies all over the place, but little t, then we can compare different systems. So let me now do this scaling. So I'll scale m by some power of t. In fact, since we already have some power written here, let's just choose that. Except here t is positive, t to the power beta. And H, I'll scale by some other power of T, I'll call it capital delta. And then what you find is an amazing thing, that all these curves collapse onto a single curve. There's one curve which describes them. So the diligent experimentalist need not spend his time or her time measuring again and again and again. It's enough to measure a little bit, check this, and then believe it. It works. This works provided little t is small, and provided h is also small, so in the vicinity of the critical point. What about below tc? Well, it works there as well. So what is the typical curve? Well, you have a jump of the magnetization. As you get closer to TC, the jump decreases. And as you get very close to TC, it's a tiny jump, but it's there. But this series of curves also collapses when you scale by the same, except now T is negative, so minus T to the power beta, H over T to the delta. And there's a universal curve. And there it is. So a single curve describes all this data. So what is the mathematical way we would write this? Nothing very profound. What we are saying is that the magnetization we thought was a function of little t and little h, function of two variables. Actually, it's a function of one variable when it is scaled itself. So what one way you can write it is simply that, okay, let me use the notation. Capital B is a fixed number which varies from system to system. It's not a universal number. It's some what's called metric scale factor. So little t to the power beta, some function, let me call it W, of H over T to the delta. So this is an example of a scaling form. M as a function of T and H, whatever that function is of course the equation of state. Just as density as a function of pressure and temperature is the equation of state for fluid, so also analog of density is the thing that jumps, namely magnetization. M is a function of T, and the thing that drives the transition, H, right? So this is the magnetic equation of state. And it looks like this. No. So what we'll say is there's a single function. It has two branches. So if you like, I mean, you can write W plus minus. It has two branches. The function is the whole thing, and it's what it is. Right. Good question. Thank you. Okay, so far so good. Now, I put these in red, partly because they refer to the critical point. Maybe I should have used a different color, because these are universal, alpha, beta, gamma, delta, nu, and they extend over all liquids, liquids, magnets, many, many things. They have some values. There's one thing here. Okay, so let us mark in red the things that are universal. Beta, capital delta. Okay, delta, I haven't told you, it's called something called the gap exponent. Related to the other exponents, we'll come back to it. So this is the same across all systems. There's something else that's the same. It's exactly the same. And that is the whole function W. It's amazing. It's not just a number, it's a whole function, and that's universal. Okay, so I'm going to make that red as well. Okay, I forgot to add a constant D here. B and D are not universal, but delta, capital small beta, and the function W is are universal. And therefore, they are objects worthy of trying to calculate or trying to find, and that is part of the effort that we are going to undertake in these 5 days. I mean, okay. In fact, fact, right now, we'll in 2 minutes or 3 minutes. Is the projection operating here? Okay, I wanted to show some quick amount of data for you all to believe all of this that I've said, and then we'll move to something else. Yes. Yes. Sorry, like what? Some other system what? Yeah. That's right. That's right. One thing, just one sec. One very important thing, which is not widely known to students, and you should know it. You should know it and propagate it, that when you are looking at a fluid, you have to look at the proper axes. What are the proper axes? The proper axis is actually the continuation of the critical flow. Imagine just doing a smooth continuum. Okay. This is the analog of H. So when you write scaling, you have to write it in terms of a linear combination of pressure and temperature, which will correspond to. Okay. So since this question came up, I wanted to say this. You have to write it in terms of, let us always use the terminology H, where H has to be adapted to the system. This is the coexistence curve, coexistence surface, it's one. This is the extension of that. And it's only along there, so this scaling form will hold if you do experiments, in some sense, crossing this, crossing that, etc. Okay, even if it's not totally clear, you ask me in some tutorial. You have to move on. Yes, can we show this? Ah, you've already done it. Okay, this is to tell you that the idea of scaling is not confined to critical points that we've been discussing in the last half an hour. It's a much wider concept and holds in many, many places. So this is something that there's a summer student visiting TCIS in Hyderabad. His name is Siddharth Mansingh, and he's produced a lot of data on some other problem. This problem has nothing to do, per se, with critical phenomena of the type we are talking about. But it's a problem of a completely different sort. An interface is propagating in a random medium, and it becomes broader as it propagates as a function of time. Now, what is plotted is the interface width, which is a function of system size L and time as a function of time, and a sequence of curves for different sizes, small size, bigger size, etc., getting bigger. You can have the next slide, please. Oh, this, what do I do? Okay, so what you do is you attempt scaling. See, here what did we do? We divided by powers of T. Here we do something else. We divide by powers of L. System size. So you squash, you have all these curves, you squash them. By dividing by L to some power, the power actually can be predicted from theory, it's about 0.63, doesn't it? And then they all squash down. But now having squashed and tasted some, you know, seen something nice happening, we'll now squish. This is squash, this is squish. So squash and squish is what you do to achieve scaling. Okay. And in this case, the scaling function is a function of size and time, doesn't matter. But here it is. It's pretty similar to what I've written there. Okay, I need the other... Okay, so now this was just to tell you that the idea of scaling is pretty widespread. And can apply in many, many places. And you see everything falls on one curve. Actually, when you do it, whether you're doing a real experiment or even numerical experiment like this, when you see scaling, you feel an uplifting, you know, feeling. And it's really nice. Those of you who have already encountered it already know. Okay. Yes. Please. Right. This is to tell you this old famous plot of Fowler and Guggenheim, 1945, shows you data for many, many liquids, neon, etc., all the way up to methane, and plotted as a function of rho by rho c and t by tc, they all fall on the same. This is the coexistence curve. You remember what the coexistence curve is? It's the curve between which there's no stable phase. I mean, there's phase separation. Okay, so an isotherm comes that way, straight and out. Okay, so let's... This is to show you exactly the two functions that I've drawn here. This and that for a magnet. This is chromium tribromide. It's a particular ferromagnet, which has been studied at many, many temperatures. So here's a diligent experimentalist. Look at the temperatures he studied at. 35.029, 33.739, et cetera, et cetera. So in principle, you should have gotten a whole lot of isotherms, but then you scale. If you can read this, this is T over TC minus 1 raised to the power beta, as promised. And indeed, all the curves above TC fall onto a curve which goes through the origin. All the curves below TC don't go through the origin, go to a finite intercept length. So this is actually useful. It's actually used. It's not just... not only a theoretical. Can we remove the screen? Thank you. I suppose I should do nothing, right? What do I do? Okay. No, but then how will this go up? Oh, it's been. Okay, very good. Okay, very nice. What are the uses of scaling? I mean, the one thing is, the first and most important thing is data collapse. It saves you from taking data again and again, and it summarizes things. So I'm taking a very pragmatic point of view. Because the fact of scaling itself is a wonder, and one has to address that at some point, but this is one of the uses. The other one is that you know, it leads immediately to lots of relations between these exponents. So let me derive quickly a couple of those, and then you'll see how it goes. For instance, let's look at the susceptibility. That's dm by dh. Okay. Okay, but now we know what m is postulated to be. So let's differentiate this with respect to h. So what do we get? Let me drop the b and d, if you don't mind. So you have t to the power beta. Now I differentiate capital W. So what do I get? W prime. Okay, derivative function of h over t to the delta. But then I have to differentiate what's inside. And what is inside? H over t to the delta. So I differentiate with respect to h, and I'll get 1 over t to the delta. Okay, but now I want to evaluate this at h equal to 0. I want the susceptibility as we approach h equal to 0. So this becomes mod t to the power beta minus delta w prime of 0. But w prime of 0 is a number. So this varies as mod t to the beta minus delta. However, I refer to my chart. Chi goes as mod t to the minus gamma. So I immediately have a relation. Gamma equals delta minus beta, or delta equals beta plus gamma. Let's do one more, and then we'll leave the rest to you. Okay, let's look at, for instance, the one that corresponds to this. what is that? We have set T equal to TC, and we have asked how it varies with age. Now, when we set T equal to TC, aren't we going to run into trouble? Well, yes, but then we'll get rid of the trouble. So M at T equal to 0, H. This is what we want. So, well, let's forget about T equal to 0. That goes as T to the beta. Let's write it again, W, H over T to the delta. So far, so good. But now I want to take the limit T going to 0. When T goes to 0, outside goes to 0, inside goes to infinity. Somehow the two must cancel. Because we get an answer, you know, which is nice and well-behaved, as at the point T equal to 0. The only way they can cancel is if the function W itself is such that the T dependence cancels. It must be. It's not that I'm pulling it out from, it has to be. This is the only way. So what is it? Mod T to the beta. Well, so this has to go like H over T to the delta. Remember, we have to cancel these. So this must be raised to the power beta over delta. T cancels out, and we're left with H to the power beta over delta. So we have another relation, but that's what we said is 1 over little delta, right? So 1 over little delta is beta over capital delta, implying capital delta equals beta delta. Now I have this, I have that. So I can eliminate delta. And here we are. So here's one of the first examples of relations between critical exponents. Okay. So scaling allows you to find relations between critical exponents. We've illustrated that for two of these. There are many others that you can find. One very famous scaling relation, which is always cited, I don't know. Maybe it was the first to be found. It's alpha plus 2 beta plus gamma equals 2. I mean, so exercise. Use the scaling equation of state that we have. Assume that it's correct and derive this alpha plus. You know, had I given you this exercise, beta plus gamma, show this, well, this is what you would have done and showed. Only one hint I have to give you, and that is, you have to relate to the specific heat exponent, right? And specific heat is a temperature derivative of internal energy, all right, or entropy or whatever. And entropy is a derivative of free energy. So it's a specific heat and a second derivative of free energy. So somehow from here we have to build up free energy. But what is magnetization? How is it gotten from free energy? Sorry? Derivative. So you can integrate. So what you should do is take this thing and imagine integrating once with respect to the appropriate variable. You'll get an expression for free energy. Then differentiate that twice with respect to temperature. Here you have to integrate with respect to field, okay? And then you'll get this. So to point out and also to make it a little simpler for you, note that in order for this to happen, the free energy, or the singular part of the free energy, must go like mod T to the power 2 minus alpha. Because two derivatives will kill. So somehow get to this. Now you have everything there. I mean, you'll be able to do it. Okay, any question? Okay, good. So at this point I've finished page 1 of 6. Right. But The rest are not as. Now, since we've touted scaling so much, and the scaling function in particular, shall we calculate the scaling function within mean field theory? This is something that Abhishek has taught you, mean field theory. You may not have done the scaling function. Doesn't matter. But did you discuss Landau theory? Yeah. I mean, anyway, the part I'm going to take, I'm just going to be very simple. So recall, step 2-3 days back, Ising model, mean field theory, M, free energy as a function of M, variational principle also you did. You minimize its respect to M. But now since we're interested in phenomenon near the critical point, we can simplify the trial free energy, which we want to minimize. So what I'm trying to do now, okay, so I should have put some headings here. Relations between critical exponents. That's derived from scaling. Okay, now, what we're doing here now, calculating the equation of state. Why equation of state? Scaling equation of state. Within mean field theory. So if you remember, there's a trial free energy which has the form am squared plus bm fourth. Does that strike a bell? Okay, yeah. It does with some of you. Except I have a magnetic field on, so I'll add a term minus hn. And what we are instructed to do when we have a trial free energy, like this is called the Landau free energy, is we are supposed to minimize with respect to M to find the true magnetization. So when we do that, clearly we'll get an equation which says that minus H minimizing, you get minus H plus 2AM plus 4BM cubed. Zero. But now, A itself is a temperature-dependent object and changes sign as you cross TC. Is this familiar? Should it be familiar to them? It should be familiar. Yeah, you should know. Okay. Recall. Look back at your notes. So A itself is proportional to what I've called little t. Let me call it C times t. This let me just call, for no good reason, U. But then clearly, this is the equation of state. It's the relation between magnetization, temperature, and field. Is it of scaling form? I'm claiming it is, because you can write this in the form H equal to M into CT plus U, M squared. Divide by mod t to the 3 by 2. So h over mod t to the 3 by 2. M divided by mod t to the half. C t over mod t plus u m squared divided by mod. T divided by mod t is plus or minus 1, depending on whether t is positive or negative. So I'll write this as, what happened to C? Okay, all right, so far so good. So I could rewrite this if I want in the form D. Recall my D and capital B, the non-universal objects. H over T to the 3 by 2 is M over B. So I'm trading this C and all that. I'm pulling out a C and calling it 1 over B or something like that. B over B times T to the half. Plus or minus 1 plus M over B T to the half squared. This is it. This is the scaling form for the equation of state. What you can do is, in your mind, mentally invert this equation. Here's an equation for H over T to the 3 by 2 as a function of M over T to the half. You can write it as M over T to the half. Some function with the b's and d's of h over t to the 3. Okay, so this is a demonstration that at least the simplest theory of critical phenomena, namely the Landau theory, actually also obeys a scaling equation of state, and here it is. You have to invert this. Plus 1 will apply above TC, minus 1 will apply below TC. So you can see what will happen. See, when this is plus 1, when H goes to 0, M has to go to 0. But when it's minus 1, when H goes to 0, this bracket can go to 0. And M goes as T to the half. So there's a finite intersection. So it's a nice, simple way to capture what is going on. Okay. Okay, at this stage, I'll stop talking about scaling and we'll switch to a slightly different thing, theoretical models. Has Kedar arrived? No. Okay, he is the person who asked me to definitely do this in this lecture. So it would have been good if you were here. Never mind. Okay. Because he's going to use this in his lecture. Kedar Damle is one of the other lecturers today, in the afternoon. No? Okay, good. All right. So let's take a 2-minute break. Think of some questions. Okay. So is it hanging together so far? I mean, is there some coherence? You know, it's just not just this, I hope not just a, you know, dropping of stray facts. There should be a, you know, some synthesis, and that is what we're trying to do. Okay, now we've discussed this phenomenon of universality, and I told you about experiments which bear it out, but also theoretically, it should be borne out. What does that mean? That means that if you have models which appear to be very different from, not very, but different from each other, they could and should belong to the same universality class. Now, introducing a new word, universality class, which is to tell you that universality actually holds, but there are actually, in the end, universality classes. Meaning that universality holds across all systems which share some very basic characteristics. For instance, that they're all in the same space dimension. Universality does not say that if you have a magnet in 2 dimensions and you have one in 3 dimensions, that the critical behavior is similar. It's not. In fact, it is not. So universality does depend on the space dimension. It also depends on the symmetry of the problem. I mean, like in the magnetic problem, where the symmetry is that of a scalar field, namely up-down type field, or whether it's a rotating field. I think Abhishek has introduced the ON model to you. This spin model with n components. And depending on the value of n, could and will, in general, have different universality behaviors. Okay? So something very intrinsic and very basic, like symmetry or dimension, will determine the nature of the universality. Okay, that was an aside. But coming back to the question I was trying to address, if we have theoretical models like the Ising model, so let me write down the Ising model. So I have a short-ranged interaction, Jij, between sites I and j, on which there are spins, which could be plus or minus one. This is the traditional Ising model. But suppose I had a spin S Ising model. In other words, the spin could go from, say, spin one could be minus one, zero, one. Okay, that's also an Ising model. TC will shift. Will the critical behavior be the same? Can somebody guess? Sorry? Yes. No. Not yes to your no. No. I mean, no to your no. In other words, it will be the same. Sorry. Yes, it is still the same. Universality. Spin one. I mean, spin one, discrete. Si equal to minus 1, 0. Suppose it's a spin 20. Minus 20, minus 19, etc. up to 0, 1, 2, 3. Will it be the same? Yes. Universality. Suppose it's something else. Will it be the same? Depends on what the something else is, but by and large, yes. So, yeah. Okay. So now I'm going to tell you about a class of models, which is particularly interesting and important, which are all in this Ising universality class. Okay. So let me just motivate it by writing the partition function. Normally, you'd write it as a sum over all configurations. Namely, all complexions of these SIs. But I won't do that. I'll write it as an integral. What's the connection? Here your SIs are plus or minus one. Here my integrals go from, I didn't say it, but minus infinity. Well, I can recover this if I force my phi to be plus or minus one. So let me, okay, don't mix up this W with the scaling function. So how do I do it? Maybe I'll put a hat on it. This is a weight function. So if my weight function has delta functions at plus or minus one, then clearly this integral will be zero unless phi is plus or minus one. And then I will recover the ordinary Ising partition function, which was okay. But having introduced the notion of weight function, I can ask, suppose I change the weight function. Suppose I make it this. Continuous function, but looking like this. The model has changed. It's a new model. Will this still be in the Ising universality class? And it turns out that if you do something of this sort, the answer is yes, it will be, and so on and so forth, right? But you know, rather than postulating some form for W, let us in fact start from the Ising model and derive an approximate form for W, which will not quite be delta functions, but something else. And that will be the Landau-Ginzburg-Wilson form for the partition. Yes. Yeah. No, so you have to watch out a little bit. But examples of weight functions for this, which it will be Ising, like for instance, still Ising. This is the spin S Ising model in the limit S going to infinity. Think about it. Because every rescaled. But you have two Gaussians, still, etc. Okay. I mean, it's true. How do we know it's true? We don't know yet. By Friday evening, you'll know. Okay, so we will demonstrate that this is true. Okay. So we don't. Right now, I'm just telling you in a plausible way. Right. Okay. Good. Is that so? Am I getting across? So as we change the weight function, provided we don't do too much violence to it. Okay, I'll give you an example for where it won't work. Okay, so let's say we have three delta functions. This is the spin-1-izing model. I told you it's still the same. It is in the same universal class, provided these are all equal weight. But suppose you begin to jack this up. Then it turns out you reach another type of critical point. Is this correct? More or less what I'm saying? Yeah. And that is called a tricritical point. And then it's still red. It's critical, but it's a deeper red. Okay, so it's a different... So things can change if you change weight functions too much. But if you don't change them too much, and there's a whole class of them which all belong to Isaac. So this is the notion of universality class. It's a class. It's not absolute. Yes, there is a tricritical function. It will have its own class, maybe a little more restricted than Isaac, but it will be there. Maybe there's that's an example of a multicritical function. And there could be higher order, and so on and so forth. So we'll see this larger scenario emerging when we discuss renormalization. Okay. But at the moment, my task is the following. Okay. I'm going to start with the Ising partition function and make it something of this form with a new sort of W, and this is how we go. Okay, at the heart of it is a familiar integral, minus infinity to infinity dx e to the minus half ax squared. Can somebody tell me the answer here? It's root 2 pi by a. You know this, right? Can you all derive this? Well, try to do it before the tutorial. Just do this. Another thing that you... which is like a corollary of this, is that e to the b squared by a can be written as an integral minus infinity to infinity, square root of a by 2 pi, because we've taken it to the other side, integral, e to the minus half ax squared, to get the sign right, plus bx. How do you prove this? Well, you complete the square here. You get an extra term. And then the integral is the same as before. This is something that is easy to prove. You must have encountered this somewhere. If not, you can just check it yourself. But now we generalize this immediately. We generalize to the notion of what is called a quadratic form. Quadratic form is something that is quadratic. Nothing much form. I mean, it's a mathematical word, but it's something that is... quadratic, except there could be many variables. You know, instead of just having one variable, x, suppose you had lots of variables, x1, x2, xn, and you had, instead of a, you had summation aij, xi, xj, et cetera, with a half, so on. There's an immediate generalization of this identity. I'll write the answer, and I would like you all to try to prove it before the tutorial. Abhishek, when is the tutorial? No, my tutorial? No, but which day? Huh? Okay. ask Rajesh. Do you want to do the tutorial? Can I do it today? Or should I do it tomorrow? Okay. No, but the okay. So you do it by 4:30 today, whether I'm taking the tutorial. Right. Okay. Okay. So here's the generalization. E to the half. This light is. Can you provide sunglasses? Just joke. Okay. E to the half. Yeah, so here you are. So I'm trying to generalize this. B hat, row vector, matrix B equals square root of determinant A divided by 2 pi raised to n. Integral minus infinity to infinity, product dxi, e to the minus half, x hat a x plus b hat x. Just write it down first, then we'll explain. So, half x hat a x is a shorthand. Okay, it's x1, x2, xn, half matrix a, x1, x2, xn, which is half sum over ij, aij, xi, xj. In other words, this thing, I'm just rewriting in a compact matrix form with row and column vectors. Is this okay? Hat means row vector. And b hat x, which appears there, is simply this, okay, b1, b2, bn, x1 through xn. That is sum over bi xi. Okay. So far what I've done is just told you that there is such an identity. How will you prove it? Well, there are many ways to prove it. One thing, just assume that A can be diagonalized. Go to the eigenbasis. And you'll be able to do it then quite easily, because in the eigenbasis, this will decouple. And you'll get a Gaussian integral for each eigen mode. And the reason you get a determinant is you get a product of eigenvalues. Okay. Can I leave this to you to prove? Try to prove it. If not, we'll prove it in the tutorial. It's a very important and useful identity, and I'm sure you'll have many occasions in your life to invoke it. Have some of you seen this before? Ah, good. Okay, then no apologies. Good. Very nice. Yes. Indeed, somewhere. Yes, indeed. Inverse. Thank you. V squared over A. In the scalar case, so A inverse here. Thank you very much. Crucial, of course. Right. Now we are going to use this. How are we going to use this? We're going to use this in looking at the Ising partition. Okay. Now, the sum over S is, except I won't use S. I want to reserve S. S is too precious a letter to be used of. We'll use the letter rho. Okay, so rho is a spin variable which is plus or minus 1. Rho 1 equal to plus or minus 1. Rho 2 equal to plus or minus 1, etc. Of e raised to half sum over kij rho I, rho j. That's equal to trace of, in some other notation, half rho hat k matrix, okay, rho. Okay. Ready? Okay. This I'm going to identify with that. So B hat is rho hat. B is rho. A inverse is K. So therefore, this can be written as 1 over 2 pi to the n determinant K, because K is A inverse. Determinant comes down. Trace integral product dsi. X's are S's. Okay, can you do the transcription or should I write it down? A inverse is K. X will become S and B will become rho. Okay, with this transcription, this is what we find. E to the minus half S hat K inverse S plus rho hat S. Okay, why have we done all this? We've made the problem messier and, you know, I mean, what have we achieved? We've achieved one thing that is very important. And that is, notice that rho hat S is sum over I, rho I, Si. S is some dummy variable, we're integrating over minus infinity to infinity. But now rho is the object that's plus or minus 1. And now it is exposed one at a time, rho I. Problem earlier was you had rho I, rho j. You could not do a sum over rho I. Now you can. So the trace, which is a sum over rho I's, can be done. So this is one, the square root times integral product dsi. Okay, so let me write this as this times, somewhere I've lost something, but maybe it's okay. Maybe not. Okay. So when I'm doing the sum over rho, this is a sum over rho. You can come here and just do it. Right? What's the answer? Rho 1, for instance, you have e to the e to the s1 rho 1. Sum over rho 1. So that's equal to e to the s1 plus e to the minus s1. Because rho could be plus or minus. That is 2 cosh. So that's the answer. For each rho I. Since I don't want things here, let me write it in the, each SI, right? So this is a product, for each of these I'll get this, but that I can write back up in the exponent, provided I can get a duster, as e raised to log. Okay, so if you like, I'll just leave it alone here. This is product I. 2 cosh SI. Now we'll do a little so this is equal to 2 to the n e raised to sum over I log cosh SI. Okay? Identity. Now I'm going to do an approximation. I'm going to expand the cosh. And I'm going to expand to the fourth order. Okay? The reason we take fourth order and not second order is because up to second order, you have a quadratic Hamiltonian with no interactions. Actually, it becomes like a harmonic solid. And harmonicity is what the essence of Ising interactions is. So you have to keep to fourth order, and you don't need to keep more than fourth order. So we'll stop at the minimum necessary, namely fourth order. So we'll write this as, this is approximately 2 to the n, e raised to sum over I, and there's a small amount of algebra which I'll leave to you. Right? Expand cosh to fourth order, and then put the results and expand log. Will you all be able to do that? First term in the cosh is a 1, so you have log 1 plus x. By the way, nowadays I'm finding people don't know the expansion of log 1 plus x. Can you, anybody tell me the first two terms? Did you say something? Just say it, one person say loudly. Why minus? Plus. X plus x cubed over 3 and so on. Minus x cubed over 3 and so on. Yeah. The minus is there, but not in the first. Correct. Okay, good. No, so you all are clearly up on it. Very good. So you'll be able to do this. And this is then half si squared minus 1/12 si to the 4. Okay, so this is all just this. Now we'll put it all together and get Z Ising. Yeah? Oh, okay. Yeah, I forgot. Yeah, here was this white line which I was not supposed to cross. Thank you. So we'll head this way now. So Z Ising is Z, I'll just put some subscript C, I mean it doesn't matter why, as 2 to the n over the square root, integral minus infinity to infinity product dsi, e raised to minus half, k inverse, oops, s I should have done, s hat, k inverse s, plus, I'm just putting things together, that's all, it's nothing new. Half si squared minus 1/12 si to the 4. It's good there's a minus sign in front of the si to the 4 term because it says that if si becomes very big, it's damped out. And given that, we don't mind either sign for the s squared. It can't overwhelm s for the large s. Okay, so this is one step you can note, but we're going to go a little further with this form. Oh, but I can't go right. Okay, so I'm going to erase this. Is that all right? So now we'll go right to left. Okay, we're going to do a next step here. This is already quite, useful step that we've taken. This transformation is known as the Hubbard-Stratonovich transformation. There's a nice paper by John Hubbard. Have you all heard of the Hubbard model? No? I'm surprised. This is a very strong demarcation. The Hubbard model is a very well-known model of electrons in a solid. You should have heard about it. You should know what the Hubbard model is. Same Hubbard. You know, so he has a very nice short paper in Physics Letters, I think, right? In the 1970s, where he outlines this. You can find this there. But, and I don't know when Stratonovich did this, but it's called Hubbard Stratonovich. Now, the last step we're going to take, I mean, since we've reached this far, we may as well do that, and then we'll rush through renormalization. We haven't come to a renormalization group yet. And remember, there's an 11 o'clock deadline for me. What is the time? 14 minutes, okay. I'm glad there's no clock here. You know, I teach in TCIS. There's a clock above the blackboard. Nobody's looking at the board. They're looking there. Yeah. Anyway, good. So, okay, but there's something here. 14 minutes, 9 seconds. What is this? Oh, I see. Thank you. Don't bother. Okay, fine. Okay, thanks. So should I use it again? Oh. I think it's all right, no? At least now that I've done the thing, I won't do it again. I mean, yeah, thank you. But I must say, I have to compliment ICTS. First of all, on the length of the blackboard, and second, on the number of dusters. It's very good. Yeah. Third, also on the quality of the chalk. Actually, I have to confess, I've brought chalk with me just in case this wasn't good. But it was passed. Okay, now we're going to take this form and sort of massage it a little more. How will we do it? Take Fourier transforms. Ultimately, that's always what we do. When you all write your CVs, somebody will ask you, what do you all do? So you write, you know, I work on this, expansion. Then you have to write skills. You can write Fourier transforms, things like that. Okay, right? All right, now, so ZC is what we want to do. Okay, all right. So ZC, okay, let me just do it here. There's integral product over DSI, e raised to, let me write it figuratively as some script k, everything there, as a function, which is a function of all the s's, right? And script k of s, I'm just going to reproduce what we had, is minus half, Si k inverse Sj plus 1/2. Except I'll generalize the 1/12 to some general number w. Universality. Whether it's 1/12 or 1/13 shouldn't matter. Okay. So define Fourier variables. Sigma q equal to sum over I, Si, e to the minus I q dot ri. And let's put in a normalization, which I'll put in as 1 over n. No normalization. But there's some normalization. 1 over root 10, perhaps. I've forgotten the normalization. I think, let me try 1 over root 10. Okay. No, let me not. Let me just leave out a normalization. Normalization will come in the inverse Fourier transform. Okay, when you write S's in terms of signals. Okay. All right. So, and similarly, K of Q is the Fourier transform of the interactions, the J's, the whatever I had earlier, namely summation Kij e to the minus I Q dot Ri minus Rj. Over J. And in anticipation of what's going to happen, I'm going to make a small Q expansion of this. Okay, let me just do it, and perhaps it will be familiar and perhaps not. This is 1 minus some constant alpha, not to be confused with the critical exponent alpha, Q squared. Is this step okay? If anybody finds it not okay, tell me, and then we'll just quickly motivate it. Okay, so let me just illustrate it quickly by taking an example. So Kij, try it out for nearest neighbor interactions. So Kij equals zero unless ij nearest neighbors. So I'm taking a typical Kij as a short-range Kij, which will do. So sum over Q, e to the iQrij Kij, let me center myself at site I. This will be 0 unless j is one of my immediate neighbors, right? In which case, I'll get the value k when it's nearest neighbor, times e to the I q. Okay, now imagine, let's say, a simple cubic lattice. So you have a site here. Where are the neighbors? There's one at plus x, there's one at minus x, one at y minus y, z minus z. Right? I mean, am I okay with everybody? I'm just not doing something in great detail, but trying to convey quickly. So e to the I q x times lattice spacing, plus e to the minus iqx times lattice spacing, plus e to the iqy times lattice spacing, plus e to the minus f. Remember, this was a dot product. I didn't emphasize it, but it was. So these are now, which is 2k times cosine qxa plus cosine QYA, etc. Expand the cosines to second order. So 2K into 1 minus QX squared A squared by 2 plus Q plus 1 minus QY squared A squared by 2, etc. How many ones do I have? As many as I have dimensions. So let me call that D. So 2D K times 1. What did I do? 2D K. Let me. Yeah, I think that's okay. I can pull it out. Minus 1. I pulled out something, so I have to put it back. 2D. Maybe, I'm not sure of this factor, but just check it. Qx squared plus qy squared plus qz, which is q squared. Check the factors, but this essentially is of the form, where did it go? Ah, here. So this is, so by the way, this is k of q. When I set q equal to 0, this term goes away and I just have that. So that's the form. K of 0 times 1 minus alpha q. So this is an illustration. Add on second neighbors, add on third neighbors, add on fourth neighbors. You'll find that the true second order, the terms just add up to the q squared, but with different lattice spacings here. So this just work out properly, this coefficient. Okay, so here we are. Now, the reason I'm, okay, let's push on. I'm going to rewrite K then in terms of the sigmas. How do I do that? Well, I have to invert this to find S in terms of sigmas. Substitute do the sums. Okay? When you do this, what you will find is the following. I won't do it in detail here. 1 over 2n, 1 minus 1 over k of 0, sum over q, sigma q, sigma minus q, plus 1 over 2n, sum over q, k of 0, alpha q squared, sigma q, sigma minus q, and the fourth order term, which is minus w over n cubed, sum over q1, q2, q3, sigma q1, sigma q2, sigma q3, sigma of minus q1, minus q2, minus q3. This is an exercise in Fourier transforms. I would urge you to try to do this soon. Is it okay to leave it to them, or should I work out? Tutorial. Sorry, they've done similar stuff. Okay. So try it. I mean, it's not difficult. You just substitute and it just works out. But this is the form that we will be, okay, let me gather terms in a more. Okay, so finally, I got the sign wrong. That's important. I hope it's right now. Yeah. Okay, so I think we will not have time to do beyond this, but let me leave you with the final answer written in some way. So K of sigma Q is minus half sum over q. Okay, so I'm going to do one more step in going from here to here, and that is I'm going to, okay, let me write the answer. We'll tell you the step in a minute. Okay, all right, so let me write it. So it's u squared plus little r, sigma q, sigma minus q, plus 1 over 2n. Sorry. Plus a sum over q, plus sum over q1, q2, up to q3. Exactly the term that I had. In fact, if you, okay. Shall we, I'm in two minds, just a minute, let me, so there's 1 over 2n, yeah, I hope I don't mess up the factors here. Okay, wait on. Let me do the following, one more step, sorry. Let me do two steps here. So this is fine as it is. It's a sum over all q's, discrete q's. Let me now take a thermodynamic limit. Meaning, let me make the system very, very large. When I do that, the sum over q goes over an integral over q. Is this okay? Sum over the first Boolean zone becomes an integral over the I mean, some over Qs in the first period goes into an integral over Q in the first period. So this becomes, then let me just write it in the final form as an integral, and then we'll leave it at that. As minus half integral dq, q squared plus r, sigma q, sigma minus q, minus u times an triple integral, sigma q1, sigma q2, sigma q3, sigma of minus q1, minus q2, minus q3. Okay. Where we've done two things. Of course, we've done the Fourier transform and we've gone to the thermodynamic limit. One, we have absorbed, we have redefined sigma q's in terms of the actual Fourier variables by rescaling them to absorb this factor of alpha k naught. You notice that what's appearing here in front of q is just one. So we've gone from sigma constant times sigma, okay, the constant depends on these, such that this coefficient in front of q squared is 1. I've redefined sigmas to do that. Is that all right? 1. And second, notice what r is. Little r is 1 over k naught minus 1 over alpha k naught. If you just do the algebra, notice that little r changes sign as we change the temperature. Okay, did I define k or not? I've forgotten. So k was beta j. Okay, kij was beta jij, where jij was the strength of the isocouple. Beta is inverse temperature. Now, the reason I'm saying this is evident here. So this is, so r is proportional to, let's look at the numerator, 1 over beta j naught, Fourier transform of jij. Just as there was a Fourier transform of kij, there's a Fourier transform of jij, beta j naught minus 1. But 1 over beta is simply the temperature. And J naught, you will remember from Professor Abhishek Dhar's lectures, is just the mean field temperature. Okay, when you have an Ising model with couplings Jij, sum over J, Jij tells you what the mean field temperature is. So this one is this divided by Tc mean field minus 1. So it changes sign as you cross the mean field temperature. This is important. I mean, it's sort of nice. You know, we did something that didn't look like mean field theory at all. We had these Gaussian integrals, 0, 0, 0. That's the time left to me. No. Okay, so I think I'll stop now, but let me just say one or two things. You know, although, the remark I wanted to make is, although the development was quite different, we actually land up with something that looks like the Landau free energy, okay? In fact, with the right coefficient which changes sign at the right temperature, except this K is not a free energy. It's a Hamiltonian. And this is the whole difference between the mean field approach, the Landau approach, where you have a free energy which you minimize. You're allowed to minimize free energies. That's what you should do. But the same form is appearing, you know, quadratic in order parameter, fourth order in parameter, gradients in order parameter, everything. But it's not a free energy. It has to be integrated over. This is very important. The distinction between the free energy, I mean, this form as a free energy and this form as a halogen. So this form, this red form, is what is called the Landau-Ginzburg-Wilson halogen. And if we wanted to describe systems, scalar systems undergoing phase transitions, and we wanted to describe them near the critical point, the Ising model, discretizing model, would be a very good starting point. Alternatively, this would be an equally good starting point. And as we'll see, when we do renormalization group, we'll do examples of actually renormalization on both forms of the halogen. Originalizing form and on this Landau-Ginzburg. But the true reason I did it today is to have the field open for Kedar. Kedar will, I think, need to start with, or at least will invoke this development. I think that this last part was a little rushed. I don't know what you all felt, but I agree. Maybe we could have the tutorial today then, and we can go over some of these things again in a less rushed manner. Okay, thanks.